Welcome back everyone to another Unreal Engine 4 tutorial, and in today's episode we shall be creating this widget right here, which we have placed over here, which can basically be placed anywhere. I just decided that this is going to be a good location and we can interact with this. It has some functions, and if we press numpad key 1, you can see it is starting to type some random code. And yeah, if we press number 2, it's going to do the same thing in a different widget. Technically, this could be a different task because those are like kind of two widgets. We are using a widget switcher and we are swapping like between two tabs like you would in a browser. So basically the content could be whatever. All I did was simply just have a different color for the same thing. So yeah, let's begin. So the first thing that we need to do is create the actual widget itself. So I'm going to right click in the content browser, go to user interfaces and create ourselves a new widget blueprint. And I'm going to call this UI hologram, even though it's not really a hologram, but doesn't really matter the name. So what I'm going to do first over here is add a border so that I can add myself some kind of a background. And I'm going to make sure that this is set to be a full screen. And I'm going to give this some tiny paddings, let's see, 40 from all the edges, so it's not entirely taking up the entire screen. Then in the brush, in the appearance in the brush, I'm going to change the background image, which I have the untitled 13 image, this one right here. So that's going to be my background image for this. Now, the next thing that I'm going to add is a thing called what is it? It's like throbber, not really sure how to pronounce this correctly, but basically this is like a loading thing, which basically has some dots coming in and out. I'm going to change the amount of these to be like 20, so there's more of them. Also, I'm going to increase the size of these to like, let's say like 50 by 50 maybe perhaps. So this is going to look a little bit better. Then also I'm going to anchor this first to the middle left of my screen, like so. And then what I will do is scroll down till I find the render transform. And under the transform, we can change the angle of this thing. And I'm going to set mine to be minus 90, like so. So it goes from the bottom up, like so. There we go. Then let's change the size of this, which is now going to be a bit complicated. Since as soon as we change the angle of this, the controls don't really work like they did before. Not really sure why it is the way it is, but unfortunately that's the way it goes. So we're going to have to change these values manually up here. And let's say we want to change the X size. So this is going to move around quite a bit. We have to be a little bit patient on this one. So let's say this is like 1000 maybe. So maybe like 170 instead. There we go. So we have that. Then we want to change the position X. I'm going to say like minus 500. Seems to be a good one. Then the position of this one should be, so we have the size at, let's say like 50, and then this one should be at minus 25. So now it's right at the edge of our screens. Then let's change the tint of this to give this some better color. So maybe more on the, well, less on the red. And now it's going to be bluish. Here we go. So that's exactly the look I want to go for. Then let's duplicate this thing. So we have another one. Let's bring it to the other side of our screens. Let's re-anchor this to the other corner, other side of our screens. And then in the transform again, let's re-angle this to positive 90. So it goes from up to down. There we go. Now we can try to align this a little bit. Where did it go? It disappeared. So again, we're gonna have to go about our values manually. So minus 25, so it's perfectly centered. And then this one seems to be like minus 560. Yeah, there we go. So that seems good. Now let's create two more for the top of our screen and the bottom of our screen. So for this one, we're gonna make this 0, anchor this top middle, and then so this is gonna be position is gonna be at 0, and the X position is gonna be, so it's gonna be minus 535 should be the middle. Yep, there we go. So we have another one there. and the last one for the bottom. So again, anchor like so, minus 535. And then this one would be minus 50. There we go. Now we want to make sure that this goes the other way around. So let's see, do we have a property which would flip this? Can't really see one, but well, in the worst case scenarios, we can always angle this the other way around. And now it does function the way we want it to. So it goes from the right to left. There we go. So it's going to look something like this. So we have our blinker things all set up. Now let's create another thing, which is the widget switcher. So basically we could have like two displays on this one, so we can display two different things. I'm going to be displaying very similar things, but you obviously can display whatever you want. And basically this widget switcher, what it does is creates like two widgets, like two screens, and you can basically display one thing at a time. So you can basically go between those. So let's align this the way we would like it to be. So mine seems to be, let's say, like this, perhaps maybe like this. Yeah, seems to be pretty good. And now inside of this widget switcher, what I want to do is add two canvas panels. So I'm going to add one. There we go. And I'm going to duplicate to create another one. Now, if we would add some kind of a content in this, so I'm just going to add a text field in this one, and then I'm going to add like a button in the other one just to demonstrate to you how this works. So we have a widget switcher, and as you can see, we have text and a button, but we can only see the text. That is because the, that's not what I wanted to do. So that is because the active widget index, if we select our widget switcher, it is at zero. So we are displaying the first child that this thing has. So it's the first canvas panel. Now, if we would change the active index to be one, it's going to be displaying the other one. So basically this allows us to switch between those two without recreating making basically a new widget. We can do all of this inside of this one single widget and just simply display one of those parts. Obviously there can be many indexes, but for this demonstration I'm just going to have two, and the contents of those, actually both of these are going to be pretty much the same. We're just going to change the color of it. So now inside of here I will add a scroll box, and I'm going to rename my scroll box to be named scroll box one, and I'm going to make sure that this is a full screen widget and that this gets filled, well, that this fills the entire widget switcher space. So let's make sure that this is a variable. So we have a variable. And one more thing that I want to do is remove the scroll bar, because whenever we fill our scroll box, it's going to show the scroll, that thingy that you have at the side of the screen. We have one right here. You can see I'm moving it. It's going to display the same thing over here, a little bit different style. I don't want to have it. So the scroll bar visibility in that case should be set to collapsed, so that it basically doesn't exist there. Now, so we have one of these, then inside of this, I want to add a text field. So inside of our scroll box, we're going to have a text field. Let's change the color of this. I'm going to make this entirely green, like so, maybe a little bit darker green, like so. There we go. And I'm going to remove the content of this text so that it would be empty by default. Now that we have done this, also let's rename this to be text block one and make this into a variable. Now what I'm going to do next is click on the scroll box. I'm going to click Ctrl C on my keyboard. I'm going to select the second canvas panel and press Ctrl V. So this basically is going to copy the entire styling, all the properties, all of this content, and just going to place it in the other canvas panel. But what I'm going to do is rename this to be the scroll box 2 and the text block 2. There we go. So that's basically it in the designer. Obviously, if you want to add more or different things to it, you can do. So I'm going to go to the graph now. And inside of here, what I'm going to do is first create a functionality which will actually generate the text for us, so that it's like a typer, so that we would see it getting typed instead of just simply getting displayed instantly. So what I'm going to do is create a new variable, and I'm going to call this full text one, and this is going to be a string. You don't need to make this instance editable, so just a regular variable, a string, full. I'm going to call this full text, and then I'm going to duplicate this one, and I'm going to call this current text. So this is going to be the current text one, And then I'm going to duplicate these variables because I'm going to have full text too, and I'm going to have a current text too. Now, what we need to do is the text that we want to display, we need to place it in our full text. So we have one over here. So I have some random code, and let's just simply paste that in here with all the enters and spaces and everything so that it would actually get displayed the way it was in, let's say, like your text editor or whatever. If you want to get this specific code, then go to the hackertyper.net. This is where I got my code from. So let's just simply add this. It's just a random nonsense code. Now, what we want to do next is actually create an event, which is going to create us type arc text for us. So I'm going to create a custom event, and I'm going to call this type text one. Then let's bring in our full text one. Let's get this. And from this one, I want to get the array. So get character array from string. And this basically is going to take our text apart, and it's going to add every single symbol into an array. What this allows us to do is we can basically get the length. We can get the length of this so that we know how big the text actually is, because this is going to then allow us to compare it to the current text. So let's get the current text, and then we can also get the length. Length from this one, so len, string len, and this is going to return the number of characters in the string, as you see. So we're going to check whether this current text length is smaller than the length of the array from the full text, like so. So then on this one, we can do an if. This is going to be our condition then. And then if this is true, if the current text is smaller than the full text, then we want to set our text. But before we set it, we want to append to this. And what we want to append is the current text. So basically the text that we have right now. And also we want to get a copy from the array, which is going to give us that one single next symbol. And this we can then plug into B. And this basically is going to add one more symbol to our current text. Now for the array's index, we want to use the length from our current text. Because like I mentioned in many of my previous videos, the lengths are always returning values from one up until whatever the length is when the arrays begin with zero. So this is going to work perfectly because it's going to return us one index higher. So basically the next needed character. So once we have done this, what we want to do next is bring in our text block one, and we want to set the text. So we want to see set text. And then we can plug in our current text value over here. It's going to convert this from a string to a text, and it's going to work just fine. And one more thing that we want to do is bring in our scroll box and make sure that our scroll box scrolls to end. So scroll to end, and there we go. So now this is going to be working just fine. So it's going to add one symbol at a time, and then it's going to also scroll down till the bottom so that we are always updated with the information. Now, the next thing that we need to do is actually launch this thing. And for that, I'm going to have a custom event, and I'm going to call this click button one, for example. And then on this one, what I want to do is first, I want this to allow me to switch between the widgets. So we have two widgets in our widget switcher, and I want to be able to switch between them. So I'm going to get the widget switcher, and I'm going to set the active widget index. Now on the first one, I'm going to set this to zero. So that brings me to the first window, and I'm going to actually create another custom event for the second one, which I'm going to call click button two. And then on this one, I want to set the index to be one. So now this will allow me to switch between these two widgets. Also make sure to connect your widget switcher to the second target as well. And then once we have done this, actually I will bring this above this, because the next thing on the click button one is we want to set a timer by an event so that the event would get looped all the time so that the text actually gets typed. So for the event, we can use our type text one, the time. It totally depends on you. I'm going to have this at 0.03, and I'm going to make sure that this is a looping event. Now we need to do the same thing for the text two. So I'm just going to simply copy this whole bunch, copy this over here, and I'm going to rename this event to be type text two. and I'm just going to replace the variables. So the full text one needs to be replaced with the full text two. We can just drag and drop it on top of the other one. So make sure you replace all of them. And then also make sure to replace the text block to the text block 2 and the scroll box to the scroll box 2 as well. There we go. Then from the click button 2, we can again set the timer by an event. We can then connect this event, set up the timer. So 0.3, make this into a looping event. Now, from the return values of these timers, what we actually want to do is from the return, we want to, what was the name? So timer, we want to clear and invalidate timer by handle like this. And we want to have two of those like this. But the thing is, we want to connect the return values to the handle, but the executions should be the other way around. So that basically whenever we click one of the buttons, it would disable the other timer. So it should look something like this. Now, once we've done that, what I also want to do is reset our texts back to being empty so that they would start typing from the top again. So on the top one, whenever we click one, I want to clear the second text like so. And then whenever we click the second button, I want to click the first text, clear the first text because, well, we are switching them between those two and we don't need the previous one to be displayed anymore. And that is all the logic that we are going to have in our widget, and we are pretty much done with our widgets. Now, let's go back to our content browser. And so technically you could now create this widget and display it like I showed you in the widgets 101 video, but well, we want to display this in our game world. So what I'm going to do for that is just create a regular actor, and I'm going to call this, let's call this widget actor. Let's open this up and let's add a component, and the component needs to be a widget. There we go. Now, if we select this component and we go to the widget class, the user interface widget class, and we select our UI hologram, there we go. We can now see this. What we want to do is adjust the draw size, because as you can see, this is a square. We don't want to display a square. I'm just going to use the most popular resolution out there. So it's 1920 by 1080. There we go. And this is like a regular screen resolution, and yeah, should be pretty cool. Now, the next thing that maybe you might be interested, depending on your situation, which you could do if you have like a transparent widget, which has, if this image, for example, would be transparent, mine isn't, but if yours is, scroll down till you find the rendering, and you might want to change the blend mode from masked to translucent. For me, it doesn't really matter because, well, none of my sections of my widget are really translucent. So yeah, that's gonna be it inside of here. The unfortunate part is, since we are setting the widget class by default, we can't really access this. Well, at least I don't know any nodes. So what I have is like a small cheat which will allow me to create the reference, and like I've mentioned in the previous like interaction videos, I think we can get a reference whenever we create something. So I'm gonna create this widget. So I'm gonna create our UI hologram, and I'm going to promote this to a variable, and I'm going to call this active widget. Not for, we want to just have the widget. There we go. And then whenever we have created this, let's bring in our widget component and set the widget. So user interface, set widget, and now the widget is our active widget. Like so. And now this basically, when we begin play, it doesn't matter what we have placed in our widget class, it's going to replace it for us, and we're going to have a reference to this active widget. Now, we want to make sure that we can actually interact with some of the things that we have inside of this widget, and for that we need to somehow enable the input of our character if we don't want to do like line traces or any other of the previous methods that I've showed in my videos. Let's just simply add a box collision to this so that this widget could handle all the controls for us. So now let's adjust the sizing. So the sizing should be around like 500 in this one, 1000 in this one, and then in the box extend like 200, so that's a little bit bigger. Bring it out a little bit so it's in front of us, so we don't necessarily have to run into it for us to interact with it. There we go. So we have a box collision in front of it. Now let's select our box collision, scroll till the very bottom, and let's create ourselves on begin overlap event, And also let's create ourselves the end overlap event. Now, what this will allow us to do is we can then get the player controller. So I'm going to get the player controller and the index is going to be 0 since I only have one character. And then what I want to do from this one is enable input, like so. Now reconnect the target to the player controller, connect the enable to the begin overlap, and then on the end overlap we want to disable the input, like so. Make sure the target is self but the controller is the player controller, so get player controller. And now this basically is going to allow us to create key events which will then function if we interact from our character. So for instance, let's create ourselves a keyboard num1, and I'm going to have a keyboard num2 events, like so. And now whenever we click 1 or 2 on our numpads, what we can do is bring in our active widget and launch a function that is living inside of our widget. So we have click button 1 and click button 2, and those are exactly the functions that I'm going to launch. So we're going to have click button 1 on num1, and we're going to have a click button 2 on num2. There we go. Compile and save this, and we are done. Let's give it a go. So let's bring in the widget actor into the world. Let's move this around a little bit, like so. Let's place it closer to the wall. Probably make it a little bit smaller as well, since it's going to be very, very huge. There we go. Bring it up a little bit, something like this. One last thing though, so we can see the actual difference. Both of my texts are the same color. Both of them are green. And real quick, I'm just going to simply recolor these to be blue. So there we go. So one of those is going to be blue and one of those is going to be green. So now whenever we walk up to this and press keyboard num key 1, there we go. You can see it is starting to type out the text. If we press 2, it is restarting it and now it's blue. And basically whenever we click any of the keys, it is resetting the text back to none and it is starting to type from the top. Now if you wait long enough, you're going to see it is going to start to scroll. And there we go. Now if this is too slow or the adjustments are not correct, obviously you can change all of those properties. You can go inside of your UI, inside of your widget, change the speed of this to, let's say, like 0.01, so it's a little bit quicker. Obviously you can change the sizing. What I noticed, what I didn't like, was that the lines were showing a little bit, so I'm just gonna make this just a little bit smaller. And there we go, the text is a lot quicker, and when it scrolls up we don't see the previous lines and it seems to be functioning the way it should. So hope you enjoyed it, hope you learned something new, hope this will be useful for you in the future, and I see you in the next one.